Welcome to China in Focus. I'm Tiffany Meyer. Our top story, Beijing is broadcasting the theories of Chinese regime leader Xi Jinping far and wide. Now they are bringing his words to a new medium, AI chatbots. But unlike other generative AI that make mistakes, the Xi bot is always right. China launching its biggest military drills in a year around Taiwan as a so-called strong punishment, ramping up pressure on Taiwan's new president just days after he took office. Flip the kill switch. Reports say one of the world's top microchip companies and its biggest buyer could shut down their machines remotely. That's in case China invades Taiwan. In a trilateral summit, leaders of South Korea, China, and Japan will meet next week in Seoul for their first three-way talk since 2019. What's on the agenda?
And if you throw the Americans into that trilateral relationship, that's really what's got the Chinese worked up and so interested in having this meeting.
Working like ChatGPT, but talking like the CCP. Beijing is going all out to train a state-owned AI chat robot. And the bot's training aligns with theories from Xi Jinping, the Chinese Communist Party's top leader. What are Xi's ideology all about, and how could this chatbot impact China and the world? Let's dive in.
China's top internet regulator designed the AI language model. Unlike other open-sourced AI chat services, the regulators guarantee that the so-called ChatGPT is fully under authorities' oversight and control. The bot's purpose? To make sure all chatbots operating in China understand Xi Jinping, learn from him, and speak for him, and that they never cross the Chinese Communist Party's political red lines. But what happens if American citizens or Chinese immigrants bring these pro-Beijing AI long arms into the U.S.? Bob Bilbrook, the CEO of a strategic consulting firm, weighed in.
You know, the chatbots that are being developed in China, you know, ideology is going to be built into that. So you're going to get biases. You're going to get biases, obviously, around how the communist, you know, how they want to approach a communist community, how they want to approach keeping control and not too much free expression or free thinking like, you know, U.S. citizens would have or do with technology.
Xi's ideologies are based on communism. The overarching aim is to uphold the leadership of the Chinese Communist Party, the opposite of the democratic systems adopted by much of the West. Analysts say one of China's objectives is to rewrite the U.S.-led international order, with help from Russia, North Korea, and Iran. Under Xi's leadership, the Chinese regime has implemented harsh policies, clamped down on dissidents and free speech, ramped up tensions with Taiwan, and lied to the rest of the world and its own people during the pandemic. Beyond that, there are the data security concerns.
But definitely in the case of this Chinese application, that data could be collected. It could be deployed in other apps. And, you know, obviously that's a danger overall to you know, at least our U.S. citizens, because nobody wants that data, including our government doesn't want that data in China's hands. And who knows what China will do with it.
Under Chinese law, high-tech companies now have to hand over key data to Beijing. Experts are worried that the CCP could use it to threaten the U.S. and the world.
Taiwan scrambling fighter jets and putting defense forces on alert. This after the Chinese regime launched military drills around the self-ruled island earlier Thursday. The drills come just 3 days after Taiwan's new president took office. China described the exercises as, quote, a strong punishment for Taiwan, with state media denouncing the island's presidential inauguration Monday. The expected two-day drills include naval vessels, warplanes, and mock attacks. NTD's Jeremy Sandberg has more.
Taiwan's defense ministry condemned the Chinese regime's drills, saying it dispatched forces and was confident it could protect its territory. The military drills come just 3 days after Taiwan's new president Lai Ching-te took office.
This pretext for conducting military exercises not only does not contribute to peace and stability across the Taiwan Strait, but also shows its hegemonic nature at heart.
The exercises in the Taiwan Strait and around groups of Taiwan-controlled islands started at 7:45 a.m. local time Thursday. The Chinese regime says it's conducting 2 days of joint military drills with its army, navy, air force, and rocket force. It released a map of drills being held in 5 areas around the island. Taiwan's defense ministry says it sent out sea, air, and ground forces in response. Some defense experts say the name of the exercises, Joint Sword 2024A, suggests another round of drills could be coming later this year. The Chinese Communist Party views Taiwan as its own territory, despite never having ruled the democratically governed island. President Lai has called for Beijing to stop its military intimidation and repeatedly offered talks but has been rejected. China's state broadcaster said Lai's inauguration speech was extremely harmful and called him a dangerous separatist. The CCP has vowed to take Taiwan by force if necessary. Lai says only Taiwan's people can decide their future. Jeremy Sandberg, NTD News.
Taiwan is responding to renewed Chinese military drills around the island. The new president's office describes the military flex as regrettable, while the island's new administration vows to continue defending democracy.
I will stand on the front line with all the brothers and sisters from the National Army to defend national peace together. At this moment, international society is paying lots of attention to democratic Taiwan. And while facing the external challenges and threats, we will continue to defend the values of democracy, protecting regional peace and stability.
The president's office says the Chinese Communist regime's drills threaten Taiwan's democratic freedoms and the region's peace and stability. Two of the world's largest chip-making firms prepared for war. According to a Bloomberg report citing unnamed sources, ASML told officials that it is able to remotely disable equipment. That's if the Chinese regime invades Taiwan. The Dutch company is the world's sole supplier of the most cutting-edge chip-making machines. Notably, one of the company's top buyers is TSMC, a Taiwanese firm that makes more than 90% of the globe's advanced semiconductors. The remote shutoff applies to the Dutch company's extreme ultraviolet machines, which are often employed to create chips used in military gear. The equipment has been front and center in the battle for chip dominance, with China trying to gain ground in semiconductor manufacturing. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen is in Italy meeting with finance officials from the Group of Seven Thursday. The agenda includes talks about China and Iran.
The United States announced strategic and targeted steps in key sectors to respond to unfair trade practices by the PRC. We need to continue to use our economic tools to counter the Iranian regime's financing of terrorist actors.
Yellen also talked about the Israel-Palestine conflict, saying she is concerned by Israel's threats to cut off Palestinian banks from their Israeli correspondent banks. She also touched on Russia. Yellen says America's price cap policy continues to restrict Russian revenues. At the same time, it helps keep global energy markets stable. Yellen's meeting with G7 finance officials comes ahead of a national leaders summit scheduled in Italy from June 13th to 15th. The leaders of South Korea, China, and Japan are readying to meet this weekend for the first time in more than 4 years. South Korea and Japan are key U.S. allies in Asia. Seoul's presidential office made the announcement Thursday.
This meeting will serve as a turning point for the three countries to completely restore and normalize the cooperative system.
Seoul said the three countries are expected to adopt a joint statement on 6 areas, including trade and technology. Balancing relations between the U.S. and China has become challenging for South Korea and Japan. North Korea's nuclear program and China's growing assertiveness in the Indo-Pacific have led Seoul and Tokyo to increase security cooperation with Washington. The two countries together host a total of 80,000 American troops on their territories. That's on top of the COVID-19 pandemic damaging the trust and ties between China and its two neighbors. But economically, Beijing remains the biggest trading partner of both Japan and South Korea. To talk more about the trilateral summit between South Korea, China, and Japan, we sat down with retired Colonel Grant Newsham, senior fellow at the Center for Security Policy and author of When China Attacks. Grant Newsham, thank you so much for joining us. Great to have you back on the show.
We're glad to be here.
Now, China, Japan, and South Korea are set to hold their first summit next week. This is the first time in about 5 years, the last one being in 2019. The aim of this is to fully restoring and normalizing their three-way cooperation on trade, climate, and of course, economic exchanges. Now, how do you view this summit in terms of the geopolitical implications for the region, especially the rising aggression we've seen from communist China?
Well, I don't think it really changes the geopolitical situation at all. These sorts of meetings are what you do. The notion that it's somehow going to bring some sort of a more harmonious relation between the relationship between the countries, I think that's not likely to happen. We've seen these meetings since 2018, and you can see the trend of how things have gone in terms of bilateral and trilateral relations between these countries. It has had no real positive effect. And if you throw the Americans into that trilateral relationship, that's really what's got the Chinese worked up and so interested in having this meeting.
On that note, we did just see the U.S. holding joint drills in the area with Japan and South Korea. This was just last month. Now, those countries, as in South Korea and Japan, have a delicate balance, if you will, to play because they do have security alliances with the U.S., while at the same time, China is their biggest trading partner still. How do you see that balance playing out?
Well, it's always a tough one. Even the United States has the same challenge. We have our business class, which is keen to do business with China, while the defense people, military, and other people are terrified of what's coming from China. So each of the Japanese and the South Koreans have to balance that. You will see the South Koreans, though, are trying to invest more in the United States. They've reduced their new investments into South Korea, into China, by quite a lot. The Japanese, the same thing. South Koreans really got hurt around 2016-17 when China took offense at South Korea putting in a missile defense battery. The Japanese have been hit repeatedly by these boycotts and even rioting and violence against Japanese interests in China. So this is not a good relationship, really, at the end of the day. It's fundamentally antagonistic in the part of both of these countries, but you have to get together and talk. And, that's all part of the game. But I wouldn't expect too much to come out of this.
On that note, we are seeing rising tensions around Taiwan and the Philippines, especially from communist China. How do you see the changing dynamics, if you will, in the region? What does that mean for the U.S. and its allies?
Well, the Chinese are coming. This is aggression in its sort of early stages. And it's a trend that, unless it's stopped, is going to ultimately play out in some real violence, or else the Americans just turning tail and running, which would mean that every other country in Asia is suddenly going to cut the best deal they can with China, the Chinese communists. And this would be the end of America, really, as a global power. China's military buildup, the biggest, fastest, certainly since World War II, but I would say in human history, is intended for one thing, and that is to dominate. China faces no enemies, yet it has gone on this buildup. And the North Koreans have to be viewed as an ally of China. So geopolitically, there's some pretty powerful forces sort of against the free world, the free nations in Asia. And you can see what's coming, and these sorts of summits don't really change that trend line or that dynamic at all.
Grant Newsham, thank you so much for your time.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Coming up, Shanghai easing limits on data exports after a push from Tesla and other foreign firms to allow more information exchange. Local authorities have compiled a list of data eligible for express transfers overseas. Freedom under siege in a city that once thrived on democracy. A House panel uncovers the chilling reality of Hong Kong's crackdown on pro-democracy activists and its deepening ties with Beijing. And meet the dissidents of the Chinese Communist Party fighting for democracy in exile. A new movie sheds light on the transcontinental suppression they are facing. More on that after the break here on China in Focus. Welcome back to China in Focus. I'm Tiffany Meyer. Shanghai has eased a round of data export curbs after Tesla and other foreign firms lobby to reduce them. Local authorities have put together a list of data that can be transferred overseas without being screened for security first. That's according to an official document seen by Reuters. NTD's Business Matters host Don Ma has more.
So specifically here, the government of Shanghai has compiled that list. It's a list of data for sectors that require the least regulation for transfers outside of the country. Now, these sectors include smart vehicles, mutual funds, and biomedicine. The newly announced data transfer rules take effect immediately, and the Shanghai government's new scheme with foreign companies include Tesla, Ford, and BMW. And this is according to a person with direct knowledge of the matter.
The erosion of freedom happening in a once democratic city. On Thursday, a House panel dove into Hong Kong's persecution against pro-democracy activists and the city's alliance with the Chinese Communist Party. NTD's Capital Report host Steve Lance brings us more. Watch.
There are lessons to be learned from Hong Kong that can be also be applied to Taiwan. We need to be clear-eyed about the nature of the CCP, the same group that promised this idea of one nation, two systems has violated that. So we need to have a deterrence.
When Britain transferred control of Hong Kong in 1997, Beijing promised to let the city keep its democratic autonomy for 50 years. But fast forward to today, when the CCP's grip is tightening ever more as hundreds of pro-democracy activists are forced into prison or exile. In many instances, the sentences were carried out through the draconian national security law that Beijing imposed on the city. Critics say the measure is designed to crush dissent outside of the regime's jurisdiction. Pro-democracy activist Francis Hui said Congress needs to take legislative action against Beijing's encroachment on Hong Kong. That includes pushing the White House to sanction those responsible for implementing the national security law.
A sculpture torched, a protester prosecuted, and a democracy movement under siege. Meet the Chinese dissidents fighting for freedom in the U.S. But even exile isn't a sanctuary. Amid threats, intimidation, and property damage, discover the Chinese Communist Party's transcontinental suppression in a new movie, Dissidents, debuting at a film festival in Los Angeles. NTD's Bill Thomas brings us more from Liberty Sculpture Park in the Mojave Desert community of Yermo, California.
At the park, you'll find many fascinating sculptures, all created by Chinese dissidents who are in opposition to the Chinese Communist Party. Unfortunately, the sculpture just behind me, it's been destroyed.
Wei Ming Chen, a sculptor and main character featured in the film Dissidents, told me his art piece called CCP Virus has been ravaged not once, but twice.
First, they used the steel chain or the tear down the sculpture. After a week, they use fire, you know, fire stick, then burned the sculpture.
Mr. Chen also told us that he had been tracked down by government spies from China before they destroyed his artwork. He says they were able to locate him by using spy cameras and GPS devices.
Because they in my car, they make GPS in my car. They know where is my car.
When Mr. Chen and the organization he's affiliated with, the Democratic Party of China, protested against the Chinese government over a variety of issues, the group claimed the CCP retaliated against them and even obstructed their activities. Dream Tao Wong, the national chairman of that group, had more to say about this when I caught up with him after the screening of the new film.
It's shocking me that even in the land of the brave, we're still facing a lot of danger and a lot of challenge.
Mr. Wong, who's also featured in the movie, says that some challenges come from China and some challenges even come from right here in the U.S.
You know, those of America elites, you know, manipulated by the Chinese government. The Chinese government uses some kind of economic benefit to manipulate them to oppress us if we struggle for freedom in China, in this country.
According to Yingchuan Liu, a law student and co-founder of the LA Committee of the Democratic Party of China, the actions of the Chinese government affect not only dissidents, but other countries as well.
The CCP's transnational repression is a threat to the USA's democracy and also an invasion of the democratic nations.
She says social awareness is a significant first step aimed at stopping the CCP's influence both domestically and worldwide.
I want more and more people to recognize the various forms of the transnational repression by CCP and also know how to resist it here, like legally.
Hua Bin said he was held against his will in China, even though he did everything legally. Hua also claimed he was brutally beaten by a Bri policeman in China in July 2019. He says the movie resonates with him on a very deep level.
I was detained in China. I was prosecuted in China. I'm totally legal. That's why I was enlightened. That's why I come to the USA. And watching this film, it reminds me of my personal story and millions of other Chinese stories who've been prosecuted, harmed, harassed, even in the United States.
He says even though he's here in the States, he still has substantial concerns about his future.
My passport lost, so I'm applying for like passport right now. So I'm really scared that they don't issue me the passport. So I have no identification if they don't issue me a passport. If we go back to China, I don't know what's going to happen.
While anti-China sentiment continues to grow in the U.S. caused by the CCP's corrupt actions, Hua wants to be sure that everyone knows the true story about China, the people, the culture, and more.
If you want to know more about China, you should know one very basic knowledge that CCP is not China. China is good, Chinese people are good, but CCP is bad. Chinese Communist Party does not represent Chinese people. Chinese Communist Party does not represent China. So we should fight against CCP rather than China, yeah.
In addition to Hua Bin, Dreen Tao Wong and Wei Ming Chen, there are countless other dissidents whose stories we're not familiar with yet. To better understand the plight of Chinese exiles in America and the Chinese government's transnational suppression, the Dissidents movie will help by informing, educating, and enlightening you. Bill Thomas and Jimmy Ma, NTD News, California.
That's all for today's China in Focus. I'm Tiffany Meyer. If you have any feedback on the show or have something you'd like to see us cover, send us an email at chinainfocusntd.com. We'd love to hear from you. For round-the-clock original news coverage, visit us at ntd.com or download our NTD app. Thanks for watching. See you tomorrow.